And at the, on the third time, it's really good mid-morning, anyway. I didn't want your break to be too long because you'd forget that you were in school, so here we are. Akhil Amar is no stranger to the university, or the Chemel Forum, for sure. A professor at the Yale Law School and one of our nation's most distinguished and prolific constitutional scholars, Akhil has given a remarkable comfort level, given us a remarkable comfort level with our precious founding document. He's making us experts, which is good. He has a virtuosic vision. He sees, and he can disclaim this, but I see it this way. He sees the Constitution in a way that a connoisseur might regard an object of art. He sees in it a depth and breadth and vitality that escape both of us. So we are among the lucky with whom he can lead us into new discoveries, new ways of looking at this political masterpiece. And I must say that I think that David Zurich's segue into it in his talking about the some of the geographic differences and cultural differences makes it all the more vivid. Akhil is going to be discussing his latest book, The Law of the Land, which focuses on how geography, federalism, and regionalism has influenced constitutional law. So please join me in welcoming him back to the podium.
It's a great honor to be back with you all. Thank you for coming. That was a spectacular opening lecture. And I think, is David here? There he is in the back. So I'm going to build right off of that. The new book, The Law of the Land, there's another one out next year. So, you know, if you want me back, I'll come back for that one. But that's still a year off. This one, The Law of the Land, starts with a map. I'm going to show you some maps here. And it builds just beautifully, David, on this extraordinary story that you told, and both of us, in turn, stand on the shoulders of folks like David Hackett Fisher and Albion Seed and others who have begun to explore the ways in which geography has always been and remains today a very important overlay on the American project. Geographic variation created by different climates, different economies, different demographies, and the initial condition, different cultures that emerge that do in certain respects trace back to early patterns of immigration, culture, economics, social organization, religion, and the like. So rather than just talk at you, I'm going to try something a little bit different. We're going to vary the format a little bit. I'm going to invite you, because you're interested in the Constitution and I'm obsessed by it, just to ask me any question you like about any constitutional topic, current or historical, and I bet at least half the questions I'm going to be able to connect up to the new book and to a series of pictures. Maybe just as a prompt, I'll just show you just a few slides that we're going to go through. So what's up with this map? Here's another map of the election of 1796 and 1800. John Adams was mentioned in David's lecture. These are the two presidential contests between Adams and Thomas Jefferson. Another map of the, looking at configuring the same data, not state by state, but county by county. Very disheartening if you're a blue person. That's a presidential election tally. David mentioned that this land was fought over and fought for. This is the top one is actually the Battle of Bunker's Hill. The bottom one is after the Civil War. Here we have Washington's family. You can see actually slavery in the form of his liveried slave, Billy, probably Billy Lee, lurking in the top right of that picture. Note there's a globe there. They're thinking about land. They're looking at a map, in fact, David. So we're on to something. And he, of course, he's a former surveyor who understands land. He's generals need to understand the lay of the land in a battlefield and more generally. This is the preamble of the Constitution. I'm always happy to talk about it or any other part of the text of the Constitution. And this is emerging in a world where lots of people are literate, as David mentioned. A written constitutional project. This is from the middle colony of Pennsylvania, middle state now, because this is 1787. third week of September. We're in the third week of September, so we can talk about that. this is a picture of the Capitol building. We can talk about how states are represented geographically and otherwise in the Capitol. This is Henry Clay with other folks listening in, including John C. Calhoun and Daniel Webster. This is Andy Jackson, portrayed as a king, holding the veto mace in his hand. This is the first political cartoon, at least it's often credited as being the first political cartoon in history, printed political cartoon. It's from 1754. It's from an obscure person. You may not have never heard of him before. His name is Ben Franklin. He's quite quite the inventor. Bifocals, Lincoln stove, all sorts of pioneering insights about the nature of electricity. This is not only, this is 1754, way before the American Revolution, the wake of the Albany Plan. He thinks the colonies have to get together. And this political cartoon, which makes an argument, you see, and very succinctly, is an allusion to a map, of course. It's configured geographically. What we think of as north to south, he's also rendering here, in effect, east to west, because that's actually the slope of America. These are 13 colonies. This is all about the erection of the 11th pillar, the 11th state to ratify the Constitution. I'm sure you've never heard of it. It's called New York. Beautiful. Again, a segue. David and I did not coordinate this. I just put this in the machine about 5 minutes ago, but I do think there are important connections. New York was the last state to ratify before the Constitution went into effect, and North Carolina and Rhode Island, you see, have yet to do so. So that's why it's the 11th pillar. This is some stuff after the Civil War, and hope you ask some questions that bear on the Civil War, which is, just to remind you, geographically defined, there are different regions. It's north against south, all about the west. I like this one. This is down a street that David showed you in an earlier form, Broadway, the great city of New York, a crusade for woman suffrage. So the pluralist campaign for liberty and equality continues. Someone asked, where are the women? Well, here are some women. More women, now of different colors. This is Washington, D.C., the March on Washington. Some of you remember it. This is a thing called Home Sweet Home. It could be anywhere in America, any century, and depending on the questions you ask, I'll tell you some interesting features of this picture. This is a great one. It's called Women Are Too Sentimental for Jury Service. and it's all about women suffrage. It's in the 19-teens. We can talk about that one. This is Washington's inauguration, his first inauguration. He is swearing on a Bible in the Anglican Cavalier tradition, very Virginia, even though it's, of course, happening in this obscure city called New York City and that you've already heard a little bit about. We can talk about other elements of this swearing in. You see John Adams, who was alluded to, right behind him on one side. Alexander Hamilton on the other side, looking kind of slightly Napoleon-esque with that sort of fist by his waistcoat, and That is, again, of course, another great New Yorker, so the theme of New York continues here. This is not New York, this is Washington, D.C. It's on the 50th anniversary of women's suffrage, and women are demanding additional rights. And so those are just some of the pictures. Those are prompts. Now, instead of telling you a lot about the thesis of the book, I'm just going to tell you one or two sentences about it and then ask you to ask me a question about something in our constitutional experience. So the book basically is different than the other two that I've talked to you about on earlier occasions. America's Constitution, a biography, takes you, the reader, through the text of the Constitution from start to finish, from the preamble in textual order through Article, which is all about how we the people ordained the Constitution, beginning in this very important year, mid-September, just exactly this time of year, 1787, the thing was put to a vote, and that's what the preamble's all about, up and down the continent. Article 1, the legislature. Article 2, the executive branch. Article 3, the judiciary. Article 4, the states. Articles 5, 6, and 7, which are about constitutional supremacy, and have this important phrase, the law of the land, that I'm going to come back to. And then the amendments are added in a chronological sequence, as so many postscripts and post-postscripts. A Bill of Rights, Amendments 1 through 10, restraining the federal government from invading all sorts of important and historical liberties in America. After the Civil War, the 13th, 14th, and 15th Amendments, ending slavery, promising all born in America citizenship, and indeed equal citizenship, and equal rights, an idea that we're all born equal, created equal, we're all equal citizens. A 15th Amendment about promising voting rights for African Americans. Then a later generation, will give us, in the progressive era, direct election of senators, a federal income tax, woman suffrage. Later cluster of amendments in our lifetime, at least lifetime of many of us, not all of us, but many of us, promising an end to poll tax disfranchisement, bringing 18-year-olds into the voting base. So that this book walks you through the text from start to finish, and therefore, at least in this final third, through American history chronologically, because the amendments are configured chronologically. Another book that I've talked about at previous conversations with you, America's Unwritten Constitution, is a reminder that there's more to the constitutional project than just the text alone. Separation of powers, that phrase doesn't appear in the text. Federalism, limited government, the rule of law, one person, one vote, separate is inherently unequal. The very phrase, the Bill of Rights, none of those things appears in the Constitution's text, but they're important parts of the project. And this book helps you think about how we, all of us, left, right, and center, we all must, in important ways, go beyond the literal words of the Constitution to make sense of it, with concepts like checks and balances, separation of powers, federalism, limited government, the rule of law. We all have to go beyond it, but we need some rules about how we can do so appropriately, how we need to go behind the text without losing fidelity to the text and to the textual project that is at it's a short text that is the core of our experience. So first one takes you through the text, and this one says, how do you complete it without undermining it? And today, I'm just going to just remind you, this new book, because it's in the title of the talk, The Law of the Land, is a geographic overlay on the same phenomenon. So first one was a textual overlay. The second was about tools and techniques of interpretation that are non-literalistic but faithful. The Law of the Land, a grand tour of our constitutional republic, doesn't need to be read start to finish. It's 12 stories, each one about a different state. And ours is a vast and diverse republic geographically. And in each of these stories, I tell you about a person or a case or an idea particularly associated with that distinct state, and hope by the end of it you understand that idea a little bit better and you understand something interesting about a different state or region. 12 states, all the regions are encompassed. By the way, and maybe this is just a good icebreaker and then you can have at me, how would you divide America? How many, what are the various regions? We've got 50 states, but functionally, what would the division be, do you think? I think there's a pretty conventional one. North, south, Midwest maybe, and far west is typically a division. So sort of the Northeast, and the former Confederacy, and the sort of the Midwest, the far west, and Texas swing. And there's a special chapter actually about how Texas actually swings multiple ways. It's where the west meets the south, and part of it's even arguably Midwest. I think the conventional view is to divide these four regions each into two subregions. There's New England and the Mid-Atlantic. And we saw in David's talk a deep division from the beginning between, religiously and culturally, between sort of basically New York on one side and Connecticut and parts north on the other, with New York, New Jersey, Pennsylvania, maybe even Delaware being Mid-Atlantic, and Old New England with the legacy of the Congregationalist tradition. And in the South, we've got the Upper South and the Deep South. We can talk about. And in the Midwest, we've got the Old Northwest and the Plains states. And within the West, maybe the Rocky Mountain West and the Pacific Rim. So these 12 chapters not only cover each of the four regions, but in fact, each of those eight subregions gets attention, and then some get a little bit more than others because there are 12 chapters. But just sort of that as a general background, what do you want to talk about? Yes, David.
The map that you're starting to show, the population map.
Yes.
Yeah. There's an inherent distortion in that, mm-hmm. much like the Mercator map is a distortion of the way the world is.
Sure.
And I've seen maps that show the United States by population.
And I had another one that redoes just this data, population adjusted. And then you see that blue is almost equal to red.
Right. And like an LA county is equal to or greater than the population of all that red above the Red River from Oklahoma.
Correct. In the next one, maybe I'll put that one next to this, so you see two different ways of configuring the data.
But you mentioned voting, so I'll roll into that. So much of our constitutions in the amendments since the Bill of Rights deal with voting. You mentioned several of them.
Yes.
The Washington D.C.'s right to vote, the women's suffrage amendments, and mm-hmm. so forth. But there has been a concerted effort to change voting over the last several cycles, because one political philosophy seems to be losing in terms of voting and one seems to be winning. Like in Pennsylvania, where the Democratic vote is in total far greater, not far greater, but at least greater than the Republican vote, but we have 13 Republican congressmen and
Perfect.
6 Democrats, and there are schemes that are being hatched in order to say, well, the state, because the states are allowed to determine how their electoral votes are distributed, we will either distribute them instead of winner take all into more fractionalization, or that the winner of the state doesn't only gets 2 votes and in Pennsylvania, and the counties count for more. If you could.
Great. Perfect. I'm going to say a little bit about the schemes in Pennsylvania, and if you want to see more about that, there's actually a podcast that Yale University has where 4 years ago I weighed in very strongly against this Pennsylvania idea and showed you why it's a partisan a sham and an assault on deep constitutional principles. So I'll tell you a little bit more about why I think that, but let's take a big step back. Because there's a lot in what you said. So one thing is, looking at this map, it looks as if red overwhelms blue, but it's not population adjusted. And people live basically along sea coasts and waterways, navigable waterways, because that's where, and it's why really Sutton robs banks. It's where the money is. That's where the trade is. So basically, the Democrat Party, just very, very roughly speaking, starting in D.C., you go up along the Atlantic coast, around the tip of Maine, down the St. Lawrence Seaway and the Great Lakes, all around the Great Lakes. You see, Ohio is really, the Democrats are along the Great Lakes. Down the Mississippi River, the West Coast, and that's the Democrat stronghold. Now, there are a few college towns in the middle of the country, Austin, Texas, Boulder, Colorado, Atlanta, Georgia, and a bunch of Indian reservations where no one lives, but they look big on that map. That's basically Democrat America. Okay, so that's one thing that you were asking about. Now, one thing that you're asking about is whether district lines, because we draw lines for both House of Representatives and state legislature, both houses, by geographic districts. We do it geographically, which is why I think it was great, David, for you to introduce geography into the conversation early on. In 2012, the Democrats won a majority of congressional votes across the country, but actually did not have a majority of congressional seats across the country. So what happened with that? Some people say that's just because the Republicans, who control many state houses, were involved in gerrymandering or gerrymandering. They drew districts in ways to benefit their party, and that is true in a bunch of places. Really, in five or six states, there's been partisan voter suppression and drawing of district lines. The states where that's really, I think, been a big issue, the big ones are Pennsylvania, Ohio, Wisconsin, Michigan, Texas, North Carolina. But that's actually a smaller part of the story, partisan gerrymandering, even though you might have been told that's a big part of the story. The really big part of the story is what demographers and political scientists call the big sort. The big sort is that Americans are increasingly actually dividing up in all sorts of ways. Our political parties are more polarized than they have been in a century. The most conservative Democrat, Joe Manchin, in Congress, is still to the left of the most liberal Republican, Olympia Snowe or Susan Collins or from Maine. There used to be conservative Democrats. In the 1960s, the most conservative people in America were in the Democrat Party, Southern Democrats, and there used to be liberal Republicans, so-called Rockefeller Republicans, and there was a geographic pattern to that, and they are no more. The liberal Republicans are no more in general. And you know who some of them are. Arlen Specter from this state, Jim Jeffords, and others, the liberal Lincoln Chafee, from New England, typically became Democrat. So there's political polarization. You know, a very strong a liberal party and a conservative party. No conservative Democrats, really. No liberal Republicans. That's part of the big sort. Part of the big sort is what we choose to experience in our information flows. We used to all watch the same three news networks and pretty much get the same information flow. Today, because of the internet and hundreds of channels, you can, if you like, only hear from folks you want to hear from and get your... So that's part of the big sort. But also, in addition to that, people are sorting into red states or blue states increasingly. There were only four states that actually, in the last presidential election, truly swung, that were decided by 5 points or less. Only four. decided by 5 points or less presidentially, Ohio, Florida, North Carolina, and Georgia. And these are, of course, the four states where North meets South, and three geographically. Ohio is where North meets South. Virginia and North Carolina are where North meets South. And Florida, you might say, well, that doesn't seem on the map where North meets South, but demographically it is, because that's where all the New Jersey and New York New Yorkers retire. Okay, so demographically, so that, and that's where America divides. America has always divided North against South. See these two maps from 1796 and 1800, the Southerner Jefferson against the Yankee Adams. Both times it's North against South. It's not big state versus small state, it's North against South. And New York is the swing state, because New York, which does have slavery, and you got asked just that question the second time around, thanks to Aaron Burr, swings. So the big sort, just to come back, people, the parties are sorting themselves out. And informationally, we're conservatives are talking and listening to and hearing from conservatives, and liberals from liberals. And the states are sorting themselves out. They're increasingly deeply blue states and deeply red states, compared to American history. And within the states, people are sorting themselves out. And that's what you see with a map like this. The cities are becoming overwhelmingly blue. Okay, so. And here's what that means very concretely. So James Carville describes this state as, you know, Philadelphia and Pittsburgh connected by northern Alabama. And that's a very famous description. And Scranton is a swing part of the state, actually, a huge swing part of the state. But if Philadelphia is now even more blue than before, and Pittsburgh is even more blue than before, just to sort of do the math very simply, imagine basically that the cities are half the population and the hinterlands are half the population. If the Democrats are winning the cities 80-20, and the Republicans are winning the other districts, basically 60-40, Democrats overwhelmingly are winning a majority of the state, statewide, but they don't have a majority of the districts. And in fact, you know, if I vary the math just even a little bit, let's say Democrats have 40% of the districts. They're winning them overwhelmingly. They're losing the other ones not so overwhelmingly. You're going to have a world in which the Republicans win more districts, because they sort of control sort of majorities, command majorities outside the central city areas. They're winning them 55-45. They're losing the cities 80-20, but they're going to win more congressional districts, even though statewide they're more Democratic voters, and that's because of the big sort. Okay, so that's part of what you were asking about, is about districting. And part of you were asking about is partisanship, and what I'm saying is that is the Democratic disadvantage that our seats in legislatures, state and federal, will sometimes lag behind. I'm a Democrat. Our statewide population counts. That's not a feature unique to America. That's true of urban parties across the world. That's true in England. That's true in New Zealand. David Cameron, his Conservative Party is overrepresented in Parliament compared to actually the number of seats, the proportion of votes his Conservative Party won jurisdiction-wide. So it's just a general feature that urban parties may be underrepresented under conditions of this big sort. People increasingly who value pluralism moving to cities. And David told us about the DNA of all that from the beginning. You know, the Jews congregate in cities, so because there are not that many of them, and they want to find fellow Jews so that they can actually have communal worship services and a community. And it's not just true of the Jews, it's true of gay people. They want to find each other, and they find each other in cities like New York. That's what Stonewall is all about, you see, because pre-internet, how do you even find other people? With a gay identity, you don't have a label, and you're trying to pass when in an era where that's being suppressed. So you come to places like New York, you find other like-minded folk, and that's why it's Stonewall in New York. This is the story you were telling. So there is, I hope you're beginning to see connections between these stories. Let me take now a step back and talk about particularly the Pennsylvania plan. But before I do that, because I told you I was going to take anything you said and using this excuse to tell you about my themes. But I don't think I've ranged really beyond the question so far. I've really been answering. So he's asking about presidential elections. Why do we have an electoral college? I mean, and then I can answer the specific question about how Pennsylvania should allocate its electoral votes, but we first need to understand why we have electoral college. I've told some of you the answer in previous conversations we have. So even if you were there, feel free to tell me in one word why we really do have the electoral college. Do you remember the word?
Constitution.
Yeah, but why does the Constitution have the electoral college? Why don't they have direct election of the president? Here's what some of you were told, so maybe actually you didn't remember that, so I got to pound it in again, okay. You were told by Mrs. McGillicuddy in eighth grade, it's because of a balance between big and small states, that's why we have the electoral college. Raise your hand if that's what you were taught, electoral college, balance between big and small states, and she was confused, and if you believe that, you're confused. Simple question, there's a couple of questions. One. Name me one time since 1789, ever, when America has divided big states on one side, small states on the other. Because I can't think of a single thing. The small states have nothing in common today and never have. Delaware, Rhode Island, Wyoming, Montana, Alaska, nothing in common. Big states have nothing in common today and never have in terms of political interest, really. New York, Florida, California, Texas. Is America on this map divided big state against small state? No. How about these maps? These are actually electoral college maps. That big state versus small state? No. Okay, America is not divided. First point, big state against small state. How is it divided? North against south, coasts against the center, cities against the backcountry. Okay, that's how it has been divided, always has been. That's what these maps show you. Okay, this is city against backcountry. These are north against south. These are north against south and coasts against the center. Okay, those are the divisions. That's point one. So if they thought it's a north-south thing, they're not very bright, these framers, and they were pretty bright. Second question. If it's a big state, small state, Mrs. McGillicuddy, I know she told you this in eighth grade. She told me this too, but she was confused. Okay. Second question. If it's a big state, small state balance, how come the big state guy always wins? We've had three small state presidents in all of American history. Zachary Taylor, Franklin Pierce, Bill Clinton, that's it. You know which state George Washington comes from, right? Which one is it? Big state, small state? The biggest! Thomas Jefferson, James Madison, James Monroe, Virginians all. That's eight of the first nine presidential elections, the biggest state. The other election, who wins? John Adams from Massachusetts, second or third biggest state, depending on how you count. Pennsylvania is also in the running. And remember, Maine at the time was a part of Massachusetts. And that takes us to John Quincy Adams, too. It's not big state versus small state. The big state guy always wins and has from the beginning. That's not why we have it. Okay, why else were you told that we have an electoral college? Because then I'll answer your question about what Pennsylvania is up to and how states should allocate. You were taught that it's because they didn't really believe in democracy. It's a republic, professor. They didn't trust ordinary people. That's why you had an electoral college. Raise your hands. But they put the thing to a vote. You know, the Constitution itself. That's this we, the people of the United States. See, because Mrs. McGillicuddy, she doesn't know what she's talking about. You know, the Constitution in the third week of September in 1787 was put to a vote, and more people got to vote on it than ever gotten to vote on anything before in human history. It's a massively democratic project. Here's what a man from Pennsylvania, another immigrant named James Wilson, says about this. He's only one of six people to sign both the Declaration of Independence and the Constitution. Franklin was another. Oh, and by the way, he gets put on the United States Supreme Court by President Washington, and he pronounces this, and this is the Pennsylvania Ratifying Convention, and he's the big framer. At the time, bigger than Hamilton, way bigger than Madison, James Wilson. Neither of them signed the Declaration of Independence. He did. He's the most prominent lawyer in America. He founds the University of Pennsylvania Law School. He's an immigrant kid made good, just as Hamilton is. And he's a kind of just embodiment of sort of New York, Philadelphia pluralism, bringing old world intellect to the new world. He pronounces the Constitution, quote, purely democratical. And in another speech, he boasted the quote, the democratic principle is carried into every part of the government. He's the one man who drafts the words, we the people. If democracy is a dirty word, why is the dominant political party in America? What's the dominant political party in antebellum America? It's the longest running political party in existence. It's the Democrat Party. They call themselves Democrats. If this is a bad word, why do they call themselves Democrats? The dominant political figure in antebellum America is whom? After the framers die off. Who's the dominant political figure before Lincoln in America? Andrew Jackson, pull out your wallet. You know, Andy Jackson, $20 bill, absolutely. He's the dominant political figure in America, King Andrew. An entire political party arises to contest him. They call themselves Whigs because they think he's acting like a king. But he says, what the heck are you talking about? I'm no king. I'm a small D Democrat, man of the people, low-born, capital D Democrat. That's my party. Democracy is not a dirty word. And by the way, it's the same word as Republican. It's just whether you're Greek or Latin. Demos kratia is ruled by the demos, by the people. That's Greek. Republic is the res publica, the people's thing, the public's thing. The party that calls itself the Democrat Party today, Jackson's party, was founded by Madison and Jefferson as the Democratic Republicans, the Republican Democrats, 6 of 1, half dozen of the other, potato, potato. So if it's anti-democratic, how come you get to vote for a House of Representatives when you couldn't under the Articles of Confederation? And there are no property qualifications to be a member of the House or the Senate, the presidency, no religious qualifications, Ben Carson. So this is massively democratic. That's not, they believe in direct election of governors. That's not why we have an electoral college. It just isn't. The data do not support any of that. And by the way, if people are stupid, why are we letting them vote for president? Because we are, state after state, and we have from the beginning. The electors have been potted plants in many, many places, and from the very beginning, and in most places, from shortly after the Adams-Jefferson second election. So in most places, from a very early point, state legislatures aren't picking the electors. People are in ordinary elections. So if the people are too stupid to pick presidents, Donald Trump, then that's been a problem that we've had from the beginning, and I don't think he's going to be elected president because I don't think the people are that stupid. In fact, more often than not in my lifetime, the better guy actually won. The people actually, way better than the coin flip, the people are not stupid. So it's not that they didn't trust democracy, because if they didn't, then then they were stupid or we are, and I don't think either of those is true. And we've had democracy from the beginning. It's a huge part of our Constitution. It's not big state, small state. It's not democracy. Why do we have the Electoral College then? Because that's not how you pick governors you see in Pennsylvania. If you just let everyone vote and you count them all up. Call you crazy, but that's how you do it. And that's how we roll in Connecticut, and that's how we roll in California and in New York and Florida and every other state. We count them all up. One person, one vote, and if it's close, we recount carefully. That's how we do it for every single state. We don't have this ridiculous electoral college thing for the governorship of Pennsylvania or California or Texas, okay? It's just, so why didn't they do that for the presidency? Because they believed in direct election of governors from the beginning, many of these Federalists, like James Wilson. They put the Constitution to a vote. It's not big state, small state. That's not the division in America, and it doesn't help small staters. It's not because they don't believe in democracy. In one word, if James Carville were here, since I invoked him, he would say it's blank stupid. You know, in the way he said that election is about the economy stupid. So why did they have the Electoral College?
Slavery.
It's slavery stupid. Exactly so. Exactly so, because without the Electoral College and one person, one vote, the South loses every single time because a huge portion of its population is enslaved. They are, David told you, slave societies rather than societies with slavery. Beautifully put. I'm going to steal that with your permission. One person, one vote, the Virginians lose. With the Electoral College, they get to count their slaves, albeit at a discount, 3/5. What do they want? How do they want to count them? Not for zero, but for one. It's not about whether slaves are voting. Slaves are never going to vote. It's about how many extra votes they get because of slavery, and they want that number pumped up big time. So they want it big. But 3/5 was way big. It means that in 1800, Pennsylvania, who cares about Pennsylvania, right? No, huge. Pennsylvania has more voters, more free people, excuse me, than Virginia. Way more voters than Virginia because it has low property qualifications and way fewer electoral votes than Virginia. You only have what, James Buchanan, the worst president in all of American history from this state, and they've got Washington, Jefferson, Madison, Monroe, and it doesn't end there. You know, they have more. William Henry Harrison is born there. Virginia dominates, not Pennsylvania, because Virginia gets extra votes in not just the House but the Electoral College because of extra slaves. Okay, Pennsylvania is has a state with slaves but not a slave state. You know, a slave society. Excuse me. It has so. Pennsylvania's getting screwed. Virginia's getting overrepresented. Okay, that's what the Electoral College is about. It's about slavery. Every single president until Lincoln is a Southerner or a Northern man of Southern sympathies. That is, a Northerner who makes his peace with slavery. And you say, oh, I don't think so, Professor. I saw Amistad and John Quincy Adams, his old man eloquent against slavery. That's when he's ex-president. He doesn't have to worry about actually winning the South anymore. Who's his vice president when he actually is president? John Quincy Adams. Calhoun. John C. Calhoun from South Carolina, and his daddy's running mate was a South Carolinian too. Okay, so there's not a single person before Lincoln who says slavery is wrong, president. Slavery is wrong and we should eventually get rid of it. Not one cabinet officer before Lincoln says that. Is America here divided between big state and small state? It's North against South, and the Southerner twice runs against the Northerner, Jefferson against Adams. And Adams wins the first time and Jefferson wins the second time because New York is the swing state. But you take away the extra electoral votes because of slavery, Adams wins that second election too. They're getting 18 extra electoral votes because of slavery, because of the 3/5 clause. And every Yankee understands that in 1800, 1801. And they're as annoyed by that as Democrats were after Bush versus Gore or something. They thought they was robbed. Okay, it's about slavery. So that raises the question, well, maybe we should just even nationally move to one person, one vote, and could we do that today? Actually, there are ways to do that, and I talk about that in the last chapter of America's unwritten Constitution. But now let me go back, finally, to what Pennsylvania is up to. So, since the Civil War, basically, every state lets its voters pick the electors. And before the Civil War, there was only one state that wasn't letting its voters do that, and it was called South Carolina. Why? Because actually, if the voters pick, it's one person, one vote within South Carolina, but if the legislature picks, it's malapportioned to favor the plantation belt, the big slaveholders. So they have a malapportioned legislature, and they want to actually control the selection of their presidential electoral votes in a pro-slavery way. But after the Civil War, every state lets its voters vote for, which, see, if people are too stupid to vote for president, every state has been making a mistake. Every single state since the Civil War, and almost every single state, basically, since the era of Jefferson. Now, there are a couple of ways to let voters pick. Almost every state today, and for a very long time, it's winner take all. Whoever wins a majority of Pennsylvania or California or Texas voters gets the electoral votes from Pennsylvania or California or Texas, respectively. There are two states that actually do it differently, Maine and Nebraska, in which actually they apportion it by who won the congressional district from that state. And whoever wins the statewide vote gets the two extra seats that extra electoral votes created by the fact that there's a Senate. Your state's electoral votes are the number of congressional districts you have plus the number of senators which that your state has, which would be two for each. So in Maine and Nebraska, basically, they do it district by district. Whoever wins the congressional districts wins those seats, respectively, and then whoever wins the state, a wide vote gets extra two. Two or three things. One, they've done that for a long time. It's never been partisan. Two, the way the math works, whoever wins the state is guaranteed automatically of winning a majority of that state. Maybe not all of them, but Maine has two congressional districts. So if you win Maine statewide, mathematically you must have won one of those districts. You can't lose in both districts and lose the state. So you win at least one district, plus, and then you get the statewide victory. So you're going to get three or four, but you're going to get at least three if you win the state. Nebraska has five electoral votes, three congressional districts. You can't win Nebraska statewide unless you win at least one district. Mathematically, you can't lose all three districts and win the state. You have to win at least one. You've got to win somewhere. If you win that district and you win the statewide, that's two more, so you get at least three electoral votes no matter what if you win the state, maybe four, maybe five. You're guaranteed if you win the state of getting at least a majority. That's not how it would be in Pennsylvania. You could win the statewide very big and lose actually a majority of electoral districts. And this is a new scheme, and it brings gerrymandering in because they've gerrymandered the districts, and it's very partisan. And there are other schemes that are also partisan, proportionate division, and they're playing you for, you know, the citizens for fools when they're proposing these things, because you should be rearing up on your hind legs and saying, no, not in the state that gave us the Constitution. Okay, so I hope that was responsive to. Okay, so I think we covered a lot of ground.
I remember the last time you talked about this.
Yes.
And you said that there was ways that the Electoral College can be circumvented.
Yes.
Could you go over that?
Yes, it's a thing called the National Popular Vote Interstate Compact, National Popular Vote Initiative. I can't remember if Pennsylvania has subscribed to it or not. It's described in the last chapter of America's Unwritten Constitution, and there's some more stuff on the Electoral College in the Texas chapter of this new book. But just in a nutshell, state legislatures formally get to choose how to allocate the electoral votes. In theory, the state legislature could pick the electors itself. It could put it to a vote. If it's a vote, they could do it by districts or statewide or proportionate, howsoever they like. But they're also formally free. If we're going to start improvising new things, they're formally free to give their electoral votes to the person who wins the national popular vote. They're formally free to do that. Now, states aren't unilaterally likely to do that. Pay no attention to Pennsylvania candidates. Just pay attention to winning the nation. So Pennsylvania is not likely to unilaterally disarm this way. But the National Popular Vote Interstate Compact, which builds on some ideas that law professors independently put out, three law professors, one named Robert Bennett at Northwestern, and two named Amar, Vic Amar and Akhil Amar. And I know this is going to be on the thing, but actually, Akhil Amar wrote that and put Vic's name on it. We have a Lenin-McCartney agreement, but in which everything that Lenin does, McCartney gets on, and McCartney-Lenin. But that's yesterday. That's the Paul McCartney song. But formerly, Vic and I did this together. I'm teasing him. He's actually he's the new dean at the University of Illinois College of Law, and he actually has come up with an important modification of this idea recently. So I'm teasing him a little bit. He's done his fair share on this. But Akhil Amar, Vic Amar, and Robert Bennett in 2000-2001, right after Bush versus Gore, floated this kind of very academical idea, just as a thought experiment. What if states basically did the following? State legislatures passed law that we will give our electoral votes to the person who wins the national popular vote if a whole bunch of other states do the same, and if the states that all agree to do it total more than 270. We won't change our rules unless a whole bunch of other states agree to this too, but if we get to 270, then that actually would guarantee that whoever wins the national popular vote would win, then these laws would kick in, the electoral votes from all the states in this consortium, which together add up to 270, which guarantees that the person who wins the national popular vote would win the whole enchilada, because you need 270 out of 538 right now. There are 535, there are 435 members of the House, plus 100 members of the Senate, that's 535, plus D.C. gets 3. That happened in our lifetime because black people live in D.C. and they were uniquely sort of underrepresented in the system. That's part of the great civil rights reforms of the 1960s, which of course gives me an excuse to remind you of the great civil rights reforms of the 1960s when people marched on Washington for a whole bunch of things, and this was one of them in D.C. Okay. Now, this is a scheme, and it's novel, and I was attacking the Pennsylvania politicians for even proposing a novel one, and you might think, well, professor, you know, take the beam out of thine own eye. Here's what can be said on behalf of this scheme. It is not remotely partisan. In fact, it might end up favoring the Republicans going forward, even though the only states that thus far have ratified it have been basically Democrat states, and about 11 have, totaling, we're more than halfway to 270 already. If someone wants to Google it, just the National Popular Vote Interstate Compact. And so New York has done it, California has done it, Maryland has done it. I don't think Pennsylvania has. But the states that have done it are mainly Democrat-controlled states, because we Democrats basically believe in one person, one vote. It's an article of principle for us. And some of us believe in one person, one vote as a matter of principle, whether or not it favors our party. We just that's what we believe. And we're willing to try novel ideas. We're a party of innovation. And the Republicans have been skeptical of this, and maybe because they think it's some retrospective slap at rebuke of George W. Bush. But who won the Electoral College without winning a national popular plurality. Al Gore nationally outpointed him by 500,000 votes. But it's actually not partisan, because going forward, it's actually, I think, the Electoral College, which used to be basically not skewed in favor of either party, is now becoming, I think, tilted in favor of the Democrats. Here's why. And it's connected to this big sort thing that I was telling you about before. Democrats historically have tended to win, in the modern era, more big states, the populist states. And with winner take all, that creates sort of an extra advantage for them. Winner take all, they win, let's say, 7 of the 10 big states. Republicans win more states overall, especially states where no one lives, the big boxes in the middle of the country. And they benefit, when they pick up those states, from the extra 2-senator bonus for Wyoming and Idaho and what have you. So they get more states overall and get a bit of a bonus. Democrats get more big states and winner take all and get a bit of a bonus. And right in the recent era, those bonuses roughly offset. So that my analogy is, it's like a fair deck of cards. There are 2 jokers in it, 1 red joker, 1 blue joker. Every so often the joker pops up and basically changes the game completely, but there's 1 red and 1 blue and it's not biased. On election day, the day before the election of 2000, I wrote 2 versions of an op-ed for the New York Times, because I thought there was going to be an inversion. The person who won the popular vote was going to lose the Electoral College vote. I thought it was maybe 40% likely, as likely as had been, and I want to be ready for that, because that's like a lunar eclipse, that's interesting. So, and I think tonight there might even be a lunar eclipse, tomorrow night? Okay, yeah, so So I saw it coming, and you know, because I'm an astronomer and I wanted to be ready for it, but here's what I didn't know. I didn't know which party it would favor. I actually thought it's probably a little more likely the case that Gore would lose the popular vote and win the Electoral College. But I thought it could run the other way around, so I wrote 2 versions of the op-ed, and indeed one happened, and the New York Times published that the next day. So, you know, I was ready. So, but as late as that, I thought actually it was the Electoral College wasn't skewed either way. But here's why I think it's increasingly becoming skewed, because the Democrats, I'll give you the data. The Democrats go into It's in the next book. You don't have that one yet. The Democrats basically have a lock on states that have over 200 electoral votes. And the Republicans have a lock, meaning they've won five of the last six presidential elections, or six, only in states adding to 110 electoral votes. The Democrats have many, many more pathways to go from 200 to 270 than the Republicans who have to fill it inside straight. We can do it with, we Democrats, without Ohio or Florida if we win Pennsylvania and Virginia and North Carolina. Or even if not that, if we get Colorado. And there are all sorts of pathways. The Republicans have to fill in, draw an inside straight sort of increasingly. They can't lose Pennsylvania, and they probably have to win both Ohio and Florida, the trifecta. Whereas the Democrats used to be any two of the three. And Democrats could actually, in theory, easily lose two of the three and still, because we've put Virginia, we Democrats put Virginia in play, and North Carolina and other places. So the Electoral College going forward might actually increasingly favor the Democrat Party. And yet many Democrats just believe one person, one vote, and they're in favor of this reform. And let me tell you one final thing. You might say, well, this seems like a kind of a scheme. We have direct election of senators. We've done this before in America. We have direct election of senators. But we had direct election of senators before the 17th Amendment in many states. Why would senators ever agree to a constitutional amendment that changed the rules on how senators are picked? Because every senator loves the existing rules. The existing rules have to be really good because they're the ones that picked me. So why would two-thirds of the Senate ever agree to a constitutional amendment, which they had to change the rules of how senators were picked? And the answer is, even before the direct election of senators, a whole bunch of states had improvised schemes like this to give you direct election of senators even before the 17th Amendment. It began, and you know this at one part of your mind, because you've all heard of the Lincoln-Douglas debates. Lincoln and Douglas are basically debating because everyone knows actually that they're running for Senate. But how is that possible, Professor? Now the other side of your brain starts to think, how is that possible because there's not direct election of senators? So why would they be sort of debating? Here's what happened. Each party this is before the 1858 state legislative election, each party announced in advance whom it would pick as its candidate for the United States Senate. It's not its candidate, it's appointee to the United States Senate, should that party win the state legislative election and control the state legislature. Republicans, before the November election in 1858, said, if we win and control the state house in Springfield, we're going to send Abe to Washington, D.C. And the Democrats said, we're going to send Judge Stephen Douglas back to D.C. Turning that state legislative election into a kind of de facto referendum of sorts on Lincoln versus Douglas. Later on, Ohio goes further. This is called the Ohio plan. I mean, it's not Ohio, Oregon, the Oregon plan. Here's what they do. When you vote for state legislature, and you also vote for members of the House of Representatives, there's a part of the ballot that's called a beauty contest. It's not binding. It's just like a presidential preference poll, except it's actually on the ballot. Whom do you prefer for United States Senate? And you actually get to check a box. Now, whoever wins that election, if you're in the legislature, even if you're of the other party, are you going to vote against the people's choice, even though that was just officially, formally a beauty contest? No, there's going to be a lot of pressure on you to vote for the person who won the beauty contest. That's 1.0. 2.0. When you run for state legislature, three things on the ballot now appear. Your name, as today, your party affiliation, as today, and three, whether you've, quote, pledged or not. You can see the P or NP, pledge, and the pledge is, I pledge to support the beauty contest winner even if that person is from my other party. Now, once you've pledged, and who's not going to pledge, because voters don't like politicians who think they're so arrogant once they've gotten used to electing senators, taking this away from me. So once you've pledged, everyone's going to be in pressure to pledge. Now, version 3.0, if you pledge, you must vote according to your pledge. Now, is that legally binding? I don't know, but no one wants to challenge it. So schemes of direct election of senators were improvised in the progressive era before we had a formal constitutional amendment. If we could do it for direct election of senators, Vic and I and Robert Bennett started thinking maybe we could do it also for the presidency. We could improvise these systems of direct election that, if they were adopted, would eventually be followed by a formal constitutional amendment. Let me mention one final way you could do it. If I could convince four people in the next year, we would have direct election of the presidency in this next electoral cycle. Four people. You know, there are five Supreme Court justices. No, the Supreme Court should not be involved in presidential selection. Judges are supposed to pick, presidents are supposed to pick judges, not the other way around. That's why Bush versus Gore is a disgrace. So it's not justices. If I could persuade the two presidential nominees and their running mates that to shake hands at a national public debate, you know, presided over by Jim Lehrer, and say we all are going to abide by the national popular vote count, there are ways of actually making that deal work. And I explain that actually in the new book, how that could actually work. How are elections actually decided in general? Not by recounts, not by courts. They're decided by concession speeches. Ordinarily, they're decided by the losing party conceding. And before the election, the parties might be able to agree among themselves about certain rules about how much money they're going to spend, or even what voting rules they're going to actually abide by. It's very interesting. That's also described in more detail in the last chapter of America's Unwritten Constitution.
Okay, all these machinations are very interesting.
Yep.
And entertaining. But if the problem is the Electoral College,
mm-hmm.
why don't we just get rid of that?
Because that requires a constitutional amendment, which requires two-thirds of the House, two-thirds of the Senate, three-quarters of the states.
It's hard, doesn't mean you shouldn't try.
Yes, I want the Constitution amended, but yeah. How do you get there? It turns out to be very difficult to bridge the Grand Canyon in one go. Evel Knievel, the Snake River, that's a hard thing to do. It's just two steps.
Okay.
Step one, we do this improvisation, and then once it works, we formalize it. Step one, we have the Illinois plan, where parties tell you in advance whom they're going to nominate for the Senate. Step two is the Oregon plan, where we have the beauty contest. Step three is with the beauty contest plus the pledge. And then we get to, now a whole bunch of senators are elected that way, and they're willing to vote for a constitutional amendment that codifies that. How do we get two terms for the presidency? Step one, Washington steps down voluntarily. Step two, Jefferson, Madison, Monroe, Jackson stepped down voluntarily. Now we have a tradition that emerges, and step three, we have a formal constitutional amendment after FDR. Lots and lots of constitutional change first occurs sort of informally and then is later codified. That's the thought. So how do you get black people... How do you get black people voting? Well, the North wasn't willing to go along with it after the Civil War immediately, so it was two steps. They first made the South allow blacks to vote because there were a lot more blacks there. And then once that happened, because that seems hypocritical, they're going to force black suffrage on the South and not on themselves. And one reason that they do is they don't want the Southern blacks coming North. So it's again about migration patterns and all the rest. So you first make the South do it, but once that happens, all the Southern senators and representatives are actually answering to black constituencies, and so now you have a whole new group of people that's willing to vote for a constitutional amendment that nationalizes it. So that's done in two steps. A whole bunch of things are done sort of in multiple steps. How do women get the vote? I know I'm arranging a little bit here, but I'm going to construe this as, okay, how do these women get the vote? Because at time T1 in 1860, no women are voting anywhere. Women can't vote themselves the vote. Only men can decide whether women are going to vote. And how do women do that? Because they can't vote themselves the vote if they don't have the vote. How do they pull themselves up from their own bootstrap? And it's a very interesting story. And it starts with these improvisations. How do you get there? In 1909, 2% of America's women vote equally. In only four states, Wyoming, Colorado, Idaho, and Utah. I tell that story in the Law of the Land book, a story about women's suffrage. How do you go from that, and in America's Constitutional Biography, how do you go from four states with 2% of America's women voting in 1909 to all the states in 1920? How do you go from no same-sex marriage in 2002 to same-sex marriage everywhere in 2015? How do you go from less than 2% of America's blacks voting in 1860 on equal terms equally, with they're all voting equally. Women aren't voting, but white women aren't either. 2% of blacks voting equally, less than 2% in 1860, to all blacks voting equally constitutionally in 1870. How do you do those? And the answer is often in steps. And the reforms, every single time, states did stuff first, very interestingly. States get rid of slavery first. States give women the vote first. States enfranchise blacks first. States did same-sex marriage first. So often, the first round of reform, states improvise direct election of senators first. Often, round one of reform is doing something interesting at the state level and then bring it to scale. So. But the ultimate goal is a federal constitutional amendment, but the question is how you get there. So is that responsive to your question?
Absolutely.
Okay. Please.
I'm going to bring up another disenfranchised population, uh-huh. That's the people of Puerto Rico.
Yep.
Puerto Rico is an unincorporated territory. Mm-hmm. Is that an obstacle to it becoming a state?
The status of Puerto Rico is discussed in... part of there's. I'm going to give you assignments. You ask me questions. And, you know, we're back at school for a day, so I'm going to say, well, there's some reading on that. So here's what's here's the next stage of David's story. It's territorial expansion, and what's really impressive is that the West is not colonized. But republicanized. It's not like the Dutch running all these outposts for the benefit of the mother country, or the English, or the Spanish, or the French. It's not an imperial model. It's we're going to take our back country and create republics almost ex nihilo, and they're just going to be land surveys and public education, and we're going to create republics as we unfurl across the country. And it's pretty extraordinary that we don't try to colonize the West, but we bring them in not as children of the mother country, the initial colonies, but as siblings, once they've grown up, once they have enough population and enough institutional structure. And that's really, really striking. And the great text that embodies this promise to not colonize the West, interestingly, emerges at the almost identical moment to the framing of the Constitution. What's the great text that promises this about the West? Yes. Say, who said that? The Northwest Ordinance.
I learned that from Maureen.
Okay. and I was born in Ann Arbor, Michigan, you see, and there's going to be a land grant idea that Lincoln's going to take. He's from the Northwest. He believes, Lincoln does, and this is the first chapter of the book. It begins with Lincoln. He says preposterous things. He says, here's what he says, Abraham Lincoln, and this actually matters. He tries to unify the country, not just north and south, but east and west with transcontinental railroads and canals. Because if you're in the Midwest, you have to be connected. You need canals and railroads to get your goods to market. And here's what Lincoln says. He says that the Union created the states. The Union is older than any of the states, and in fact created them as states. Now, boy, that looks weird to Robert E. Lee, because as David told you, the Lees have been running Virginia, these Cavaliers, and the Lees come from Cavaliers, from the 1640s on, when they are fleeing the English, the Cromwellian Republic. And that's Robert E. Lee's great-grandparents, or great-great-grandparents, you know, and uncles, and what the heck are you talking about, Abraham Lincoln? Virginia was there first. It created the Union. That's how it looks to you if you're if Virginia, especially if you're a Lee. But if you're Abraham Lincoln, first of all, you're not just a Virginian all the way down. You're born in Kentucky. Your dad came from Virginia. Your grandfather came from Pennsylvania. Before that, you think your people came from New England, although you're not quite sure what. So you're like Ben Franklin. New England is all sort of one cultural entity. And then you move to Indiana and then to Illinois. You're not a state person. You're an American, much more mobile. Your identity is nationalistic and not state-based. But when you move to Indiana, it's a territory. The federal government, it's not yet a state. The federal government is organizing as a state, and Illinois too. You move there because actually you know you own that land. He told you that with Stuyvesant it wasn't quite clear that the Indians understood land ownership. Well, that's a problem even in Virginia and Kentucky in the backcountry. The land surveys are crappy and the titles are unclear, and you're not sure, even though you've worked the land, whether it's really yours or legally speaking you're squatting, and in order to actually get clear title you might have to pay some lawyer 500 miles away. Weeks away to engage in lengthy litigation over all that. So heck with it. You leave Kentucky, which has all these screwed up Virginia land title issues. You go to Indiana. And the federal government has set up good land surveys. And now you own that land. So if you're Lincoln, you believe the Union created the states, you see. So this Northwest Ordinance idea, which also promises that it'll be free from slavery. And that's word for word for word, that slavery clause, the 13th Amendment. The Union Army is the backbone of it, demographically, if we're being an Albion Seed, David Hackett Fisher person, is all the old Northwest. They come from Ohio and Illinois. People like Grant and Sherman and Lincoln and John Bingham and Edwin Stanton and all these Phil Sheridan, they're from Salmon P. Chase, from the old Northwest, okay? And we do not make Ohio a colony or Michigan a colony or Illinois a colony. We make them great republics, which is what Reconstruction is going to be about. We're going to try to actually turn the South back into proper republics. We're going to treat the South the way we treated the West, as they've reverted, in effect, to territorial status, and they need to be brought back into proper horizontal sibling relationship with their sister republics. That's the idea. And then at the end of the 19th century, America starts to think about its own world empire. And there's a slight betrayal of this vision of non-colonizations of other people. And that's the Spanish-American War. But I think our deep DNA as constitutional societies, we should not have colonies. We should not do to others what the Brits did to us. So is Puerto Rico status illegitimate? No, not in my view, because Puerto Rico is not clearly, unequivocally asking for independence or statehood. The fundamental problem in Puerto Rico is there are three different factions, none of which has a clear parties. Groups, either which has a clear majority, each of which has only a plurality. Some like the status quo, some want statehood, some want full independence. And until they basically figure out what they want, it's difficult for the rest of us in America to have some sort of self-determination idea that can be operationalized, because they haven't made clear exactly what they want. They haven't made clear that they reject the status quo, and if they did, which they want, independence or statehood, because the status quo is this awkward relationship. But they need to figure out if they say, we want statehood, and if you won't give us statehood, we want to be on our own, I believe that our deep, unwritten Constitution would compel us to acquiesce in that, because even though the Constitution doesn't say so in so many words, our unwritten Constitution very much travels through the Northwest Ordinance and the anti-colonialism principle. So is that responsive to your question?
I think one comment is that the Puerto Ricans don't always know what they will get if they vote for statehood.
Yep. Yeah, be careful what you wish for. Yes. Maury.
I think it's accurate to say you're a great admirer of Lincoln.
Yes. And I begin the book with him.
Yeah. Chapter 1, Illinois, Lincoln, foremost constitutional interpreter.
Yep.
How do you respond to those critics who say Lincoln ignored the Constitution, and he ignored it in the ways that you know better than I, suspending habeas corpus, blockade, calling 75,000 men, troops, and on.
Excellent. So I am a huge admirer of Lincoln, a man who had less than a year's formal education in his entire life, not higher education, K through infinity, you know, largely self-taught, kind of.
Wait, don't talk too much about this. I'm giving a lecture on this.
Oh, okay. And he takes a solemn oath in heaven to preserve, protect, and defend the Constitution of the United States, which is the law of the land. I believe that virtually everything that he did was faithful to that. So let's go back to geography. Here are the key facts you need to understand. That in back in the day, Congress was often not in session. This was a good thing. Maybe for the country, definitely for the congressmen, because pre-air conditioning, the place is unlivable in. When Fort Sumter comes under attack, and it's a vast country, you see, and there's not, so we go back to geography, and you can't just take jet shuttles back and forth over the weekend. So if you want the members of Congress to really be connected to the folks back in their districts, it's a huge cost if they are spending their time in this imperial city cut off from the grassroots, because they can't commission polls the way we can today as easily. Their information flows are skewed, and they're not back there just hearing from people. So we come back to geography, so it's different then. When Sumter falls under bombardment in mid-April, Congress is not in session. So someone needs to act. And so here's one of the most important things to understand about the presidency. It's a 24/7, 365 position. It is vested with power to keep the country going as a going concern, especially when others aren't around. If Lincoln does nothing, the Capitol falls, and the war is over before it's even begun. Because if you stand at a certain point, at his time, now there's an old executive building, but when he was there, from a certain point to the part of the White House, you look across the river, and you see Robert E. Lee's plantation. Right there, it's 5 miles away. It's right there. Today we call it Arlington Cemetery. Okay, and Virginia is a slave state, and they're going to secede soon. They secede as soon as Lincoln basically takes some steps. So Virginia falls very soon. Congress is still not in session. Lincoln calls them into session immediately, and he says, "I want you to be back here by July 4th. Why so long? Because this is mid-April. One, because he thinks he might be able to manage the situation a little bit. But two, it takes time to get disengage from the farm. This is a special session. They weren't due to come back till December. So he calls them back early. But if he doesn't act unilaterally, if he doesn't call up troops and suspend habeas corpus, Maryland will fall. He gets, I think, 2 or 3% of the vote in Maryland. He gets zero popular votes south of Virginia. It's a very divided, the map, okay, what are these maps, by the way? Oh, you give me a good excuse. So what's the bottom map? That's Obama, okay? That bottom map. Now what's the top map? That's the election of 1896. America is divided the same way as it's always been, but what's the kick in the head? Blue on the top, that's the Republican Party. The parties have flipped. The party of Lincoln nominally today is the former Confederacy. The party of Lincoln really today is the tall, skinny constitutional lawyer from Illinois is named Barack Obama. He's a Democrat. He basically has recreated Lincoln's geographic coalition. Okay? But it's a sharply divided one, north against south. And where's Washington, D.C.? Thanks to the initial power of the Virginians, it's on the banks of the Potomac, and it's wedged between two, not societies with slavery, but slave societies, Virginia and Maryland. And if you don't take immediate action, Maryland will fall too, and then you're surrounded. Then it's checkmate in three moves. Washington, D.C. is wedged between them. You're absolutely surrounded. The capital is indefensible. In getting to his own inauguration, because the way the railhead works, he has to go from one rail station to another one, and that's controlled by basically hostile pro-slavery sort of mobs, and he has to sneak through the dead of night, and he's not sure that the Union troops, which he needs, the Yankees from New York and Pennsylvania, are going to be able to reinforce Washington, D.C., because they have to go through Baltimore, which is secesh through and through. So if he does not take action immediately, there will be no capital to come back to. So he acts temporarily in an emergency, in extremis, all above board. He calls Congress back immediately. He says, you must pass laws authorizing everything that I've done. And if you think I have done anything wrong or my colleagues, here's what we've done. You should impeach us all. But we did this so that you could convene. Because if we did nothing at all, the Capitol would have fallen. And it would have fallen by force of arms. An election, fair and square, would have been undone by force of arms. Bullets would have trumped ballots. Democracy cannot survive if people who lose an election fair and square overturn it by force of arms. And if that happens, the world will have lost, in Lincoln's phrase, the last great hope of earth. The government of the people, by the people, for the people, will have perished from the earth, because all the European democratic reforms of the late 1840s have failed. Okay, 1848, 49. The Dutch have lost their republic. The United States is like the only republic concern going, and even England is still doing all sorts of imperial things that are profoundly anti-democratic around the world, in India and other places. We are the one great democratic experiment. We have to make it work. And if people who lost an election fair and square can overturn that by force of arms, democracy is a sham and delusion. The rest of the world will have seen that the American democratic project failed, and you wouldn't be living in the world that you live in today, which is a profoundly democratic world. So Lincoln understands all of that. So what he does in an emergency, when Congress isn't in session, to enable secret policies, and says, you have to fund all of this, you have to pass a law authorizing, in effect, the suspension of habeas corpus, and done all these things, but I had to do it because you weren't here, and I was elected to preserve, protect, and defend the Constitution of the United States. And I think he makes a very good argument for that. And you'll see my defense. Oh, in chapter one, here's another amazing thing that he does. He holds and I highlight this in chapter one. He holds a fair election in 1864. We hold elections, compelled or high water, and he expects actually to be voted out of office on August 20th. Third, 1864, he writes a memo that he makes all of his cabinet officers sign. It's called the secret memo. And he thinks at that time, late August, the war isn't going so badly, the surge isn't working, and that he's going to be defeated by McClellan and his copperhead Vice President Pendleton, who may just hand victory to the South. But he holds the election anyway, fair and square. And here's what he says in this secret memo. Our job is to work as hard as we can until Inauguration Day to win the war and then hand over the keys. What an extraordinary commitment to government. And he says this in his first inaugural twice. He uses the word 4 years. If you don't like me, just wait 4 years, vote me out, and I will go peacefully. They don't do this, even Britain. Parliament just, whenever it wants, suspends elections. There's no parliamentary election between 1935 and 1945, not one. Not even a by-election. No one voted for Churchill. There was just all the existing parliament members sort of agree to extend their terms of office in a great government of national unity, and what they're unified about is that they get to be in charge. You know, all of them. We don't do that here. That's not how we roll, thanks to Lincoln. We hold elections in the middle of great depressions and world wars, and Lincoln's the person who does that. It turns out well for him, because 1 week after this secret memo, he makes all the cabinet officers sign. He doesn't show it to them, but they basically sign the back of it. He says, I want you all to be witnesses to what I've committed ourselves to. But Atlanta falls at the beginning of September. Now it's very different. The end of the war is in sight, light at the end of the tunnel, and he's resoundingly reelected on an anti-slavery platform that will lead to the 13th, 14th, and 15th Amendments. Yes, my hero. And he has a very Midwestern view of the world in all sorts of ways that I show you in the first chapter. Yes?
Question about the Supreme Court.
Yep.
How they can overrule previous decisions.
Yes.
Explain that to me.
Because they take an oath of office, as do all federal officials, not to their religion, Ben Carson, but... and you see, 11 states had state constitutions that had religious tests at the time of the Constitution. Pennsylvania is one of them. A 12th state has a religious test by statute, New York. So it's more liberal than the others because it's not in the Constitution. And only one state has no religious test. It's Virginia, and that's merely by a statute that could be changed the next day. So one of the most important things in Article 2, which is very short, doesn't spell out all the emergency powers of the president, but it's implicit in the idea that there, he has executive power. Which, going back to Locke, who mentioned Locke in the first, is understood as actually a certain prerogative, executive power, to act in emergencies for the public good. It goes back to Machiavelli and others. It's understood as a part of the, Stuyvesant has to do things to hold the fort. Basically, that's what you do when you're an executive. So, no, I lost my train of thought. The Supreme Court. So you take this oath of office, and it's to the Constitution, and the presidential oath of office doesn't say, so help me God. The British thing has to be sworn by a bishop or archbishop. Has to be an Anglican Bible, not a King James Bible, not this Catholic Douay Bible stuff. And you have to say, so help me God. You've got to kiss the book. You've got to swear to be defender of the faith. We don't have any of that, Ben Carson. You can say it, but it's personal religious choice. And the U.S. Constitution, this is revolutionary in the world. It says there won't be a religious test. Okay? And this is revolutionary, and not just on paper. The two of the guys up there on Mount Rushmore are not members of any formal denomination. They're not regular churchgoers, Jefferson and Lincoln. There are 9 justices. I'm getting to the court. It's a Protestant country in its founding, mainstream Protestant. 4 guys, 9 guys on the Supreme Court, 6 Catholics, 3 Jews. No mainstream Protestant, and it's not a big deal. See, for us and for the world, this is spectacular. 4 guys ran for president or vice president last time around. Only one is a mainstream Protestant. His name is Barack Hussein Obama. Because Biden and Ryan are Catholics, and that was no big deal. And Romney is a Mormon, and that was no big deal, because Democrats did not demagogue on this. We did not. And this is great for America. And Boehner is a Catholic, and Reed is a Mormon. Mitch McConnell is a mainstream Protestant. I think McCarthy, I don't know. I don't care. It doesn't matter. But, you know, there was no religious test at the Alamo, Jack Kennedy sort of tells us. And this is, we are a light unto the world in this regard. India, there are 170 million Muslims, but it's Muslims and Hindus and Jews and Protestants and Catholics and Sikhs and Jains, Buddhists, all living together. And there have been Muslim presidents, you see, of India. Not prime ministers, but presidents, and on the Supreme Court. So this is great. And we should not lose this lightly. This is a great thing that we are giving to the world. And you heard where it began, I think, with the pluralist origins in New York City, not really the Puritan, not really the Mayflower stuff. Okay, Plymouth Colony. No, it's New York. But what are they swearing their oath to? Not to the Constitution. Now, if the case is wrongly decided, the case says, this says equal in 1954. But the case on the books, named Plessy versus Ferguson, says, forget about equal. It's really about racial separation. Now, you're a judge. You've taken your oath not to your religious denomination, nor to other branches of government, nor to previous case law, but to this. So to be faithful to this, sometimes you're not only permitted but obliged to repudiate prior misinterpretations and deviations from. In Brown versus Board of Education, you can either take seriously what this says, which is equality, or you can follow the case law, which says forget about equality, Plessy versus Ferguson, but you can't do both. Now, in Chapter 5 of America's Unwritten Constitution, I try to explain why sometimes you're supposed to follow precedent, and here's where, and most of the time you're supposed to follow what the Constitution, as you understand it rightly, says, but I try to tell you when you do one and when you do the other, because that's one of the deepest questions for a justice, is when you follow your best understanding of this text that you've sworn an allegiance to, and when you follow the precedent. Every justice that I know has sometimes done one and sometimes done the other. Many of them are not very systematic about when they do that. I try to offer some very specific rules about when you should do one and when you should do the other. But in a nutshell, because they've sworn an oath, not to the Supreme Court and their predecessors and the case law and to precedent, but to this. And it doesn't have to be a religious oath, and that's why they can swear or affirm this. I do solemnly swear or affirm that I shall faithfully execute the office of President of the United States and will, to the best of my ability, preserve, protect, and defend the Constitution of the United States, full stop, nothing else. But the or affirm was precisely to accommodate especially Quakers in the great state of Pennsylvania who had a tradition against swearing but preferred affirmation. So even in that, you know, in this... the Constitution is the supreme law of the land, and everyone takes an oath, not just the president. That's Article 6. So I come back, and Sandra is, I think, is telling me it's time to get off the stage. But Article 6 says the Constitution is the supreme law of the land, not what South Carolina wants, but the Constitution itself. And then it immediately says, and everyone takes an oath of office to uphold it. But even in these oaths, you see actually geography there a little bit, that you can swear or affirm because ours is a tradition of great pluralism and inclusiveness. And the or affirm is actually a tip of the hat actually to the state of Pennsylvania and the Quakers. But this is at the heart of our project. Not Supreme Court case law, not what the president wants, not what Congress wants, but this.
Before we repair to the lobby for the book signing, followed by lunch, and then followed by some real special treats this afternoon, I do have a question. What is your next book?
Well, two things. One, invite me back and you'll hear more about it. And fingers crossed it will be out in mid-September of next year, just in time for the general election. It's called The Constitution on Deadline, a real-time essays on the issues of our era. And it collects various and reflects upon various op-eds and other things that I've done for The New York Times, Wall Street Journal, LA Times, Washington Post, Slate, The Atlantic, et cetera, on the big constitutional issues of the last 25 years. Chapter on the Electoral College and Bush versus Gore, because that's the big drama of Bush. Chapter on the Clinton impeachment, because that was the drama of his presidency. Chapter on Obamacare, because that was the drama. So the three recent constitutional dramas, Obamacare, Bush v. Gore and Electoral College, and the Clinton impeachment. A chapter on the presidency and the role of dynasty in all of that. So here's one thing that I didn't tell you just about Washington's picture. It's not scrolling quite. There we go. So he's got the world at his feet, you know, the globe, the looking at a map. But it's a slightly sad picture. No one's looking at each other. It's a little stiff form. This is in the National Gallery of Art because he has no son. to carry on his name, Rising, S-U-N, but not S-O-N. You can trust him because he's not going to try to create a dynasty. So there's a chapter on the presidency and dynasties. I don't know why people might be interested in that today, but apparently there are. Chapter on the vice presidency, chapter on the Supreme Court, chapter on the culture wars. So all the fun stuff of the last 25 years. Constitution on deadline.
Thank you. Thanks. David.